Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 27 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the absolute delight of chatting with none other than Dr. Taunya A. Lowe, aka the Riot Starter. With more than two decades of career experience, Dr. Taunya A. Lowe offers expertise in training, leadership, development, strategic planning, and coaching. Dr. Lowe is an innovative, insightful change agent who understands the concept of adding value to others. As a trainer and presenter, she is witty and engaging while offering practical solutions. Author of Wanna Start a Riot? Change, Affirmations, Confirmations, and Prayers, national and international trainer, consultant, and coach, Dr. Lowe's has an impressive human services background which spans many disciplines, which include nonprofit organizations, academia, government, corporate consultant, strategic planning, leadership, and professional development. I met Dr. Lowe at a networking event here in Atlanta, Georgia, and we became quick friends. And let me tell you, she is the genuine article when it comes to adding value to others. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Dr. Taunya A. Lowe. Dr. Lowe, thanks so much for joining me.
Oh, thank you for having me, Timmy. I'm so excited about talking with you today.
Awesome. So you have a LinkedIn profile that is second only to the beauty of your spirit. Podcaster, author, professor. You just had your fifth, not one, two, three, or four, but five Riot Starter Symposiums. But it wasn't always like that. And we all got to start somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug? And how did you become enchanted with starting riots?
Oh, wow. You know, Timmy, thank you for that question, because I agree. You know, I didn't just wake up as the Riot Starter. However, the Riot Starter spirit was always inside of me. I always knew that I wanted to be a consultant. I am in the consulting space, but I've always been that encourager, that motivator, and that really helping people get through, develop their transformations. I come from a human services background. But I'll tell you, in my business, the place that really, you know, coming from years of being in government and human services and then starting my business, it was the 5-year mark where I was in my business and I took a tremendous loss. I lost about $32,000 in my business. And you know, for any small business, that could capsize you. I mean, that 32,000, some people don't make that in a year. And so from that experience, I had to pick myself up and decide, where do I go from here? I've come too far to go back. You ever been in the middle of the ocean and you're like, okay, I need to just either keep swimming to the island or go back, but I'm too close to where I want to go to go back. So what I did was I got engaged. I got engaged in a community. I did some assessments on what happened, because, you know, when you experience losses, they take knock the wind out of you, and it's really hard to get back up. And so I knew that I had to get back up. I knew that I had started something that needed to continue. And so I got involved in community. I did an assessment of what went wrong, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And then I realized from that I needed to be in community with people who knew more than I knew. I needed to diversify my income streams and my product streams. I don't know if any of your listeners have ever been there where, you know, you're on one ride and you think that ride is going to last forever. And then when it crashes and you realize, wow, if I diversified, I wouldn't be here. And then I also realized that I needed to create some things. And so out of that loss, Timmy, the whole Riot Starter movement was birthed. You know, the one thing that probably should have taken me out, I used that as a catalyst to birth this movement. I wrote my first book, Wanna Start a Riot, Change, Affirmations, Confirmations, and Prayers. Another 9 months later, I had my first symposium. And from there, I started developing programs to truly supplement the government work that I've been doing, the consultation work that I've been doing, and really saw that it all blended together. Everything, it didn't stand alone, it all blended together. But now, from that loss, it taught me that I learned something, I had to do something, and I had to create something. And so that's the story of kind of where we are, how we got to where we are today.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that. So, if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum, yes, we watch Doctor Who. What are the top three things that you would tell yourself to help prepare for your career?
Wow, the top three things I would tell myself would be get involved in international business. I come from a human services background, the helping professions. And so if I'd done that years ago, I'd be so much far advanced now. So I would say get involved in international business. I'd also say get connected in a community of with people that can help you grow. And I would also say never, ever, ever give up. The road is going to get tough. It's going to be hard, but you're made for this. You were born for this.
Amen to that. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future because one of the things that I really like in the digital marketing space, because you are one heck of a marketer. I know I didn't read that off when I was rattling off your credentials, but let me tell you, folks, Dr. Lowe is no slouch. She's on everything. She's on Facebook Live, she's on Periscope. I mean, she does her thing. And one of the things that I focus on is mobile slash connected devices, and we're getting into the whole Internet of Things. And sort of the cliche example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered to you via Amazon drone, right? And in that scenario, that's what they call a closed loop system, because in that scenario, you don't actually have to leave the house. Everything is just done for you, sort of like the Jetsons, right? So, how do you see marketing evolving in that scenario? Because some people are worried, like, okay, our marketer's gonna have a job, but it's like, the milk has to get in there in the first place, right? So, what's your whole take on that whole futuristic scenario?
Oh my God. Tammy, I think marketers will always have a job. And I believe that because there's so many people, even though we're in the technology age, it's not technology and marketing and all of that is the wave of the future. We're here. But even though we're already here, there's so many people, business people, career people that want to make a huge shift, and they don't know how to do that. They have huge messages, and they don't know how to do that. And it's as simple as, the example you just gave. How do I get the milk? I don't want to leave the house. How do I get the milk into the refrigerator to, feed my family? And so I think that marketing is just going to continue to evolve in a way that's going to just truly help people grow and develop their businesses and their dreams at levels where they never could have even imagined. Never could have even imagined. I mean, right now we're talking to people in other countries, but at some point, we're going to be talking to people in on Mars and Saturn, So I
Elon
believe.
Musk gets his way, yep.
Yes. So I believe that. I believe that. So I believe that, to folks that are listening, keep evolving and growing and learning one bit at a time. I didn't evolve into this. And thank you for saying I'm a heck of a marketer because I had to get there. I had to grow there. But in order to grow there, I had to be open to it. And so I hope folks that are listening to this that may not be where you want to be open to trying something and just growing from there.
Absolutely, I tend to agree because it all comes back down to people. And as long as there are people, there will be a need to persuade people, there will be a need to connect to people because we're basically social creatures. So Very good answer. So you, Gary V, and Brian Solis, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, you're all chilling at the bar after the conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Wow. Okay. Let's see. So we're sitting around, we're having some cocktails, and I would say, listen up, guys. One of the things that is truly missing from the digital space is the opportunity to bridge technology marketing to with people who really don't understand it. You know, this marketing world, it moves fast and it's innovative. But it moves so fast, sometimes we leave people behind that don't know how to jump on the train. They want to be on the train, but we make it scary. And so we've got to find a way to not make marketing scary for people that want to jump on and fly with us. We've got to find a way to get people involved, to share their genius with the world, and use marketing as the vehicle to do that. So sometimes, and even, you know, and I can say that because sometimes I feel left out because of the things I don't know. And then you talk to a marketer and they, because they know it, it's like, kind of like that teacher, they know math, but they can't teach you math, but they know it and they're off to the races. Or have you ever been in the gym? You ever been in the gym and the person is, they're teaching that aerobics class and they're so into it and you're trying to keep up and you trip all over your step. Sometimes right, marketing right. is like that. We're moving so fast because we're excited. We forget that we've got to go back and help those people who really, really want to learn it and slow it down a little bit.
Yep, it's called the curse of knowledge. It's when you learn something at a high level, it becomes difficult for you to talk to somebody who doesn't know it because you've forgotten what it's like because you're so deep into it. And I tend to agree because marketing has changed more in the last 2 years than the preceding 50. But a lot of people's mindsets haven't caught up, and we have to do a better job of bridging that gap. We absolutely have to. So we are going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Dr. Taunya Lowe. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttimmy.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Dr. Lowe, without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means, express yourself.
Okay.
What's your take on the whole fake news controversy surrounding Facebook after the results of the election? Because for those of you who don't know, in the last 3 months of the 2016 presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, we mean that these stories were wholesale fabricated. They had no factual basis in reality whatsoever. It wasn't a simple matter of spinning a story one way or another. There were no underlying facts to spin. The whole thing was a fairy tale. And afterwards, Facebook has come out and said that it's going to start cracking down on fake news. And that has really sparked a debate within the digital marketing community, because you have one side saying that Facebook is a platform only. Facebook has no business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have another faction saying that, hey, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you have a pool in your backyard. And while you're away on business, some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool, and one of them drowns, right?
Right.
You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property, and you are ultimately responsible. So where do you fall on this whole sort of debate?
So, Timmy, you know, fake news, alternative facts, none of this is new information. I think that, you know, as consumers of information and as people who produce information, we have a responsibility to share information that we have done our own research on, or share information that we feel is real because we've done our homework. I don't believe that we should share information that is not real because of how we feel about something. I believe if I'm sharing anything, I'm going to share the facts. I'm going to do my own homework. Because I think that as a marketer, that it's about integrity, and it's about integrity. Everything goes back to integrity, which is one of my core values. And so regardless of what you do in the world, people are always going to remember how you show up in the world. And so, you know, there's been, you know, fake news out way before the whole political thing. You know, you see it and people will say, oh, that's not, how long have they been saying Facebook is going to start charging us? Okay. You still see that it's fake news. So I think that as producers of information, that we have to do our homework and we have to be aware of what we're putting on our property, whether that property is your Facebook property, your Twitter property. You have to be very cognizant and aware of what you're putting out. I receive so many things and people will say, oh, share this. But then when I go back and I do some homework on it, it's not something that I want to attach my name to because it's not real information. So I think we all have a responsibility to share the facts and know the facts.
True indeed. So large corporations have just really recently begun getting serious about digital marketing. For a very long time, they were treating digital marketing, in particular Facebook and social media, like a fad that they were just, you know, waiting for it to blow over. And now that it's become very clear that that's not going to happen, they've actually started putting resources to it. Not as much as they do traditional media, depending on the vertical, especially in the B2B space, but at least now in a lot of corporations, you have a department or a position when it comes to digital marketing, where as early as 5 or 6 years ago, you didn't even have that. Like, they didn't have anything. And so as corporate dollars have begun to flow into the digital marketing space, they have disproportionately gone toward Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. Like, those two entities get the lion's share of the digital ad spend. And as the corporate dollars flow in, the laws of supply and demand dictate that, as you know, there's more competition for a limited ad inventory, that those ad prices are going to go up, and the smaller players are going to get pushed out by the big corporate dollars. So do you think that we'll have a scenario where, you know, Facebook, Google, these other properties are sort of controlled by these corporations dumping their elephant dollars in? Or do you think that the internet will remain open and free?
Oh my God, no. I think that as corporations invest, they want something back. Just like if I'm going to invest, I want something back. So if I'm investing in a platform, I want ad space. Or if I'm investing in a booth at a conference, I want access to your audience. And so I think that if we are to think that, oh, wow, it's so great that big business, they are investing into social media platforms, there is a reason behind it, and they want something. They either want our contact information, they want access to us. So I think we are going to see a shift.
So do you think that shift is going to push out the small guys? Because you might see have a scenario where, you know, at, like I said, as those corporate dollars flow in, that the cost per clicks, we've seen them steadily rise. So do you think the smaller guys will still be able to compete with the big boys, or are those elephant dollars going to kind of edge everybody else out?
You know, I think, quite honestly, Timmy, I think that we're probably going to see a rise, you know, in the small guys. So it's going to, if you're a small business, it's going to make it harder for us to compete. I do believe that. I think it's going to make it harder. It's going to make, we're already seeing a rise per click. So I think, as you know, they're not going to need our small pennies. Mm-hmm. They're not going to need our money, because if I've got Coca-Cola investing, you know, big dollars, then, you know, yeah, I can raise your per click rates. But I think it's going to be at a point where their investments, and I hate to say this, but I think it's just reality, that they're going to get more out of their investments with the bigger companies. So we, as smaller businesses or middle businesses, are going to have to invest more to reach the people that we're trying to reach. And I'd love to hear, you know, the social media pioneers, I'd love to hear their thoughts about it, about how they're going to keep it viable and cost effective for small business. But, you know, business is just that. It's business.
Too true. And I would love to hear their answers to that as well. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his podcast, but I'm steering it in a very particular direction. And I want you to understand why it is that I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it.
So, okay.
In my personal and professional opinion, there's a severe gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a corporation or at an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a John Lee Dumas or Pat Flynn. That's not who I'm talking about. Even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level, I'm talking about people with jobs, right? Right, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. And in terms of professionalizing oneself, there's sort of three major tracks, right? You can start off meandering the wilds of Google. And while there's a lot of good information out there, a lot of it's free, rooting it out does take a little bit of skill. You might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up in Amway. Like who knows how that Google sort of rabbit hole was going to shake out. Another path you could do what I did which is go back and get a degree in internet marketing. The cons there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 from an undergraduate, and it's time consuming because even though the degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And when you're talking about the online space, 30 months is several lifetimes. But by far the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem there is that even though in aggregate it's a lot cheaper than getting a degree, you got to have that money up front. So look at some of the better conferences like a South by Southwest or a Social Media Marketing World or a MozCon. You're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, food, Uber, just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you factor that other those other things in, you're easily looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And so what ends up happening is that a lot of people get priced out. And if you look at the demographics and the audiences of these things, you don't tend to see very many people of color. Like I've been to some conferences where it was me and two other people, and that was it, in a room of 500 people. And so what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to sort of crowdsource a way of professionalizing oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or you know, having to come up with a bunch of money for a conference that's cost prohibitive. So now that I'm done rambling for however long, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world,
okay,
identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money.
Ooh.
That's right. Our college freshman broke, Dr. Lowe. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
I would get on to social media, and I would get on social media 3 times a day, and I would in the morning I provide some type of inspiration, and I would invite them back to join me at lunchtime where I would teach them something, and then I'd invite them back in the evening where we can have some type of laser coaching, hot seat coaching, where I would solve their problems, and I would begin building relationships with them. And I would do that the entire, you said I had 30 days?
Mm-hmm.
I would do that every day for the entire 30 days and use that as a vehicle to develop offline relationships and business opportunity.
That is probably the most structured answer I've ever gotten. Like, so seriously, people sort of, you know, build up or collect their thoughts and remember, no, you are on it. I love it. Dr. Lowe, please take a moment. Tell us about Riot Starter. Tell us about your books, your podcasts, any course you got coming out, your social media. Where can we get some more of you?
Wow. Thank you, Timmy. I always tell people, just connect with me by going to drtaunyalowe.com. There you can experience our programs. We've got a couple of amazing programs. The Blueprint 90, for those people who are struggling with getting started or you keep stopping. I have a Blueprint program designed to get you started in 90 days or less. I want to partner with you and help you start your riot. What is a riot? A riot, I'm not talking about knocking over taking people's TVs and knocking in their windows. People get so upset when they hear that term. But whenever you want to make a change in your life, you want to do better, be better, grow better, you feel that disruption. You feel that disruption, and it's like a riot. You tell people that you want to start a business, you want to write a book, and they don't bring positive energy to you many times. And so for a lot of people, they feel like they're stuck between, do I start and follow this dream, or do I just continue with the status quo? And so I tell people, start the riot anyway for your life, your business, your career, but most importantly, Timmy, your legacy, because it's what those things that you create for your legacy that will carry on. And so I create riot starters in the workplace, in the business field, and individually as well. So visit me at drtaunyalowe.com. It's drtaunyalowe.com. And we'd love to get you involved in our Riot Starter movement. You can join our Facebook group, Riot Starter Nation, where we are just a community of people supporting people starting their riots.
There you have it, folks. DrTaunyaLowe.com. Head over there right now. I can personally attest that she practiced what she preaches, and she is the genuine article. So, Dr. Lowe, thank you so much for your time. If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.